So last night's episode of Supergirl sure had a lot of Frankenstein references, some of them quite overt. They were like, get it? We're doing Frankenstein. Are you sure you get it? If you don't get it, here's another reference. But on that note, I think that while Frankenstein dreamed big, Dr. Frankenstein dreamed big, and in this case, Maxwell Lord dreamed big, I think that the show didn't dream big enough. And perhaps it might have, in the process, discovered its own kryptonite, and that's that Melissa Benoist doesn't have that much range as an actress. Maybe that's not the case. I'm going to try and give her the benefit of the doubt because she's so good as Supergirl, but then that would mean that the show didn't trust her enough to have that kind of range, because I thought that Bizarro just did not work out because they didn't go for it. And we'll talk about that because in the top five worst things of the episode, because that's definitely number one. There were still some good things, but I think the 1-2 punch of not executing the Bizarro storyline well enough and kind of having Kara's very frustrating personal life kind of take over this episode were two punches that the episode couldn't recover from. But I have to say, I couldn't fit it in anywhere, but I wanted to just give a shout out to the ridiculous, like, 90s-esque soundtrack of this episode, where they had, like, these really cheesy, like, Michael Bay ballads, like, come up really loud over two scenes. And one was the kiss, the romantic scene between Adam and Kara, and then also Jimmy Olsen's speech to Bizarro toward the end. I was like, man, it's like Steven Tyler could just like actually come out and sing "I Don't Want to Miss a Thing" and like tear, and I was like, ah, come on, you're better than this, Supergirl. But before we get into the best and worst for last night's episode, I want to give you a heads up about next week's episode, which is called For the Girl Who Has Everything. And this is actually a take or an adaptation on a very famous Superman story. A story so famous that they actually even did it on Justice League, the animated series. Now, also somebody last night tweeted and said, well, I guess is Supergirl just going to redo famous Superman stories? And I think there's something to that, but we'll discuss that next week. I mean, I guess it kind of comes into play today because also Bizarro and Supergirl, I think if she's going to succeed as a character, she has to have her own iconic moments. She just can't do the female feminist version of Superman's iconic moments. But the reason I bring up next week's episode is because you might want to do a little bit of prep. Now, I'm a firm believer in the fact that entertainment shouldn't require homework, so you don't have to go and read this, but it's a short comic book story, it's not like a huge commitment, and it'll put you in a little bit of better perspective for next week's episode to see what they do with it, you know, if you want to judge it from that perspective. So I've put a link actually in the video description to where you can get this online. This I think you might only be able to buy it as part of an anthology, sorry, but I'm sure it's a pretty darn good anthology, because Alan Moore is the writer. It's actually from Alan Moore and Dave Gibbons, the team behind Watchmen, and it's definitely one of Superman's most famous stories. And also, I'll put a link, if I can find it, to the Justice League episode as well, just so you can be totally ready for next week. And that episode itself is actually called For the Girl Who Has Everything. We're going to talk about girl versus woman later on in this episode, because that definitely made an impact on me in the worst list. All right, so, but what did I like about the episode? Let's start on a positive point. I really like Peter Facinelli as Maxwell Lord. I think he does a fantastic job. And he is, you know, we've been talking about how bad Vandal Savage is over on DC Legends of Tomorrow, but Peter Facinelli proves how vital it is to a show to have a great villain. And I think he's fantastic. I mean, imagine if it was just Astra, right? Aunt Astra, the show would suck. But Maxwell Lord, I think, is proving to be a lot of fun. Even if he has the craziest hair. I'm like, who does your hair, Maxwell Lord? You know, John Jones keeps pointing out that you're a billionaire, but it's sticking out all funny in the back. I think you should, you know, take care of that. I'm like, is it a wig? What's going on there? It's very bizarre. But I think he's really relishing, Peter Facinelli is really relishing his role here. And they're finally turning Maxwell Lord into the cool character that DC Comics has always wanted him to be. He actually had quite the face-off with Wonder Woman in the comics. But, you know, she actually snapped his neck, which was, you know, side note, one of the things I was upset about giving that moment to Superman in Man of Steel. I was like, hey, that's Wonder Woman's moment to make a bad decision and kill someone, you know, to cross that line. But anyway, Maxwell Lord, he was always just kind of like a plot device, right? Like, who's Wonder Woman going to kill without there being major repercussions across the entire DC universe? But finally, I think Maxwell Lord is coming into his own as a villain. Now, sure, he's Lex Luthor light, but Jesse Eisenberg, we're going to have to see what he does in comparison, because I think Maxwell Lord is playing a very good Lex Luthor, basically. Now, I love the Frankenstein references, and they were super, super strong with Maxwell Lord. For instance, he said, "She's alive." When the experiment didn't kill poor Jane Doe. Also, he directly quoted Mary Shelley, which I thought was hilarious. Also, they took a little bit from Clockwork Orange with the conditioning of this Bizarro, and I thought, you know, it was like Maxwell Lord only knows stuff about science from the movies. He's like, that's where I got my education. I'm the Quentin Tarantino of mad scientists. But I did appreciate the references. But I think they really did, drive home the seriousness of the situation as well, which I also appreciated. That it took him 7 tries to do this, which means he killed 6 people. I mean, sure, they were brain dead, but, you know, they could have possibly been revived. He revived this one. Also, I do think he keeps things interesting, and this is like a Maxwell Lordism that he can call his own, is that he continually confesses to things, to at least to Alex Danvers. Maybe that's how he flirts, but he's always like, well, but actually he did it to Supergirl, I believe, too, right? Earlier on, where he's like, well, if I were to do that, this is what I would do. And I'd be like, ah, Maxwell, you're so sure of yourself, you never even dreamed that something bad would happen to you. And also, by the way, we'll get into what happened to him in just a second. But I loved also Peter Facinelli's expression when he was looking at Bizarro when she came back after being hit with the kryptonite and her face was all cracked. I like that he looked at her like, you go, just disgust me, you broke my toy. Like, he wasn't masking it at all. So, I mean, partially maybe he was trying to, like, you know, get her ready to try and be even more angry with Supergirl, but I think there was some personal disgust there as well, which I thought was fantastic. And I loved Alex arresting him. I thought that was really, really fantastic. I thought that whole exchange was great. I love Maxwell Lord versus these two sisters. I think they're making it very interesting. And at the same time, who would have guessed? It's strengthening, I think, the sisterly bond, not only between the two characters of Alex and Kara, but how we see them. And so I think that's really great. I love seeing Alex and Kara work together. And I like them being so strong. I like that she's like, I'm going to arrest you, Max, and I don't have to report it because I'm with the DEO. I thought that was very good real world allusion to what happens to actual today. And then I thought Maxwell Lord even pushed that further when he said, wow, Supergirl, you really are truth, justice, in the American way, because there's nothing more American than locking somebody up without any due process, for an indefinite amount of time. I was like, he's got you there, Supergirl. You know, Maxwell Lord, he might be a little bit annoying and, very dangerous, but he's super clever. So I thought the whole Maxwell Lord stuff was excellent. I'm very curious to see how that storyline develops, because at the end of the episode, he was still in containment. He should be more concerned, though, because he knows they have a shapeshifter on their team from his security footage, so they could arrest him indefinitely without anybody ever noticing. And I'm surprised that didn't occur to John Jones as well when he said, people are going to wonder where he is. They're like, no, they're not, John Jones. Get out there! All right, so the second thing that I liked about the episode was that I liked that Winn was back in the mix of things. And he's also on a truth tour. I was like, preach it, Winn. You tell Jimmy Olsen what's going on. And we're going to get back to that later on in the worst things in the show. But I did like having Winn back. I'm glad he didn't lose any of his spunk. And I'm glad they found a way for him to still be part of the group while not pining for Kara. So I think that's good. I think the next best thing they can do is to get him his own love interest or his own, like, agenda, something to do. Maybe turn into the next toy man. I still think that's there, but we'll see. The one thing, though, is I didn't appreciate him saying to Jimmy, leave the bottle. I was like, that's to save Jimmy from himself, right? You're not going to become a drunk, are you, Winn? So I thought that was bad. It's not cool to drink alone at your desk by yourself at night. All right, so anyway, the third thing that I liked about the episode was Cat Grant. I think that Calista Flockhart continues to be a huge asset to this show. And I think they did a lot of interesting things with her character last night. And I liked her motherly instincts kicking in with Adam. I mean, look, we should have known that Cat would eventually become a great mom as well, because she's great at everything that she does. So I thought that was really good. I thought that she handled the very difficult situation with her daughter, her son dating a work colleague, and the way she resolved it at the end when she was like, let's just go back to, boss assistant relationship. I thought, Kara's lucky that she didn't find a way to fire her. I mean, Kara could have sued, I guess, but it was not good. And I think a lot of that was on Kara, which we're going to get to in just a moment on this list, actually. But I thought that I liked a lot of the things that Kat did also as a reporter. I thought that the way they had that discussion about what the headline should be was really clever. I liked that she took Supergirl not gone mad or gone rogue, but Supergirl gone wild, a play on girls gone wild. That is a great headline. I thought that was really great to see someone working, even if it was fictional like that. I thought that the fake Supergirl headline, though, I can see while it would make a good headline, Kat's supposed to be a little bit more of a responsible journalist than that, and she never said to Kara, what's the basis? How can we make that claim that maybe this is a fake Supergirl? I think Supergirl with a question mark was a good way to resolve it, but it seemed a little bit too convenient to the storyline there. Also, I didn't understand how she came up with the name Bizarro, except for the fact that that's what the character is called in the comics. They didn't show any organic evolution of that name for Cat Grant. And also, it seemed so not Cat Grant to call it Bizarro, so I didn't get it. But the Amber Alert joke that she made also, like, where have you been, Kara? I almost put out an Amber Alert. I thought that was great. So Calista Flockhart is just, she's approaching Vanessa Williams on Ugly Betty levels for this show, and that's high praise. Now, the fourth thing that I liked about the episode was that interrupted kiss, because the kiss was pretty nauseating. As I said, the music was too high, the whole thing, you know, the nepotism, the whole thing is reeking of nepotism that he's on the show, her husband in real life, so I was not having a good time. But then I was so thrilled to see Bizarro break up that kiss. I didn't see it coming. I was so involved in my disgust in how the scene was playing out that they totally surprised me. So I thought that was cool. And I also loved that the audience, I'm sure you did as well, came to the realization that, wait a minute, Maxwell Lord knows what Supergirl's secret identity is because he knows who Alex Danvers' sister is in real life. It's very easy, one and one to put together as two. So I thought that was a great way to make it clear that Maxwell Lord knew about her secret identity. I thought that was fantastic. It was really great, good. It created a oh crap moment for Kara and for the audience. So I loved that. I thought that was very well done. Then finally, I was really glad to see Adam go. You know, Brody Jenner from Glee, he looks nothing like his photos. You know, I had just, you know, it's funny, I didn't realize that was her husband, and a lot of you pointed that out to me last week when I said they had chemistry. But I was actually looking at photos of him because he's up for the Han Solo role recently. So I couldn't believe that I didn't recognize him. But, you know, he changes his hair. He, like, totally changes his look because he kind of has that bland, you know, like, pretty boy network TV look. But I really didn't like him being on here for nepotism. I felt that, you know, it was a clear case of, hey, we're both actors. I got a big break. My husband isn't doing as well. Can I please give him a role on the show? It will make things better for us at home, and it would allow me to do a solid for someone I love. And it's like, I don't think that's a good idea, especially because Kara's love life is a mess. And she doesn't need, you know, taking her back to a place where, oh, he doesn't know why she has to go. It's just, it's not good for the show. I don't think it's a good idea. And so I was really glad to see him off, to go off. And also, I think it's irresponsible for Kara to date somebody at work, especially somebody who doesn't know her secret, because, you know, it's going to create a lot of tension, and that's going to, you know, trickle over to Kat, as it did. So I was glad that was a short-lived relationship, and I hope it doesn't come back ever, quite frankly. So I put it as one of my best things, because he's gone. All right, so what were the worst things of the episode? Unfortunately, this week, this list is the stronger of the two. And that's actually, I think, the first time that's ever happened. The first episode, it was 50-50, but I was surprised at how bad some of the elements were on this show. So number one, by far and away, is Bizarro. And Melissa Benoist just did not go far enough with this character, or wasn't pushed to go far enough, or wasn't allowed to go far enough. This is Frankenstein's monster. And instead, it just seemed like the unpopular girl at school, you know? And I think that even there, they could have done something more interesting with it. It was or a mirror version of Kara. Why couldn't it be a mirror version of her personality-wise as well? There were so many stronger choices that could have been made here. There could have been the monster. There could have been the exact opposite of Kara personality-wise. They could have gone with the Lex Supergirl romance that I've mentioned before and have Maxwell Lord become involved with this version of Supergirl. That would have been super creepy, and I think actually kind of interesting, right? And it would have created a weird love triangle between Alex and her, you know, a fake copy of her sister. So I think that would have been really interesting. I just think there were so many different things to do with this character, and they didn't pick any of them. And it created a really uncompelling villain. For some reason, they decided to make her just, they really played up the fact that she was a victim and that Maxwell Lord was the villain. And that's really a waste of Bizarro. Now, Bizarro is always supposed to be conflicted, of course. That element is there. But Bizarro is also a danger, and they just really never explored that. And by making Bizarro, the monster of Maxwell Lord, it just really became an extension of Maxwell Lord and, you know, took out a really iconic person in Superman lore. So I didn't like that at all. I did like the fire breath, which looked very cool, and the freeze vision. I didn't get the freeze vision. I was just like, why are your visions two different colors? I'd forgotten that Bizarro had opposite powers of Superman, because they haven't played that up in the comics too much recently. It's usually more just the, you know, saying everything the opposite, right? That's usually the big joke. And they haven't really focused on Bizarro's powers that much recently. So that was a good way to remind us of, like, the cool aspects of Bizarro's power set. So we'll see. And I also think the actress that they picked to play Bizarro when she, I don't know, and I was like, where's you know, ability to shapeshift come in? I mean, why aren't we talking about that? And where did that ability go? But I thought that the actress who eventually became Bizarro, I thought she was even worse than Melissa Benoist. So the whole thing, I think, was a wash. Then the second thing that I didn't like about the episode, and I saw a couple of you tweet me about this, and that was the fight choreography. I think we can all agree it was really poor. It seemed super staged, which was unfortunate. And I want to, you know, draw a parallel here to women's sports. And one of the reasons that people don't watch women's sports is that they're not particularly exciting. And this is actually, you know, something that people say about women all the time. I was recently reading an article about women on Wall Street and how women should be in charge of Wall Street because they're more responsible, even though they're not as exciting in the financial decisions that they make. And this idea that women are boring and not exciting has got to go. And shows like this don't help. A female action sequence between, you know, two women should be just as exciting as if you had two men fighting. And we've seen it done. Of course, the fight in Man of Steel is absolutely fantastic with that German actress, Antje Tejul, I think her name is, that Zack Snyder choreographed. I mean, it can be done. It can be amazing. I'm hoping for some great fight sequences in Batman v Superman with Wonder Woman, but I haven't liked the fight choreography that we've seen so far from the Wonder Woman movie. And so that is like, and I think Charlize Theron did a nice job in Mad Max. And they just have to really work hard on having women have as good and exciting fight scenes as men. And I think that this episode of Supergirl was a prime example of just really bad fight choreography. There was no tension, there were no stakes. It seemed almost like they were doing like a dance, like a cheerleader dance, and that is like really embarrassing. All right, so the third thing that I didn't like about the episode is that Supergirl's secret club at work, clubhouse, needs some female members. Just having her, Jimmy, and Winn is getting super creepy and uncomfortable because they both still have feelings for her. So it's like they don't really care about the mission. They don't really care about Supergirl. They're just there to spend time with her, and it's awkward. Neither one of them can because Jimmy's in a relationship. Winn has been rejected. It's just like, it's just too weird. It's like some weird, like, penthouse letter it's becoming. Like, well, we go upstairs at work and have awkward pauses together. And you're like, I'm glad that Winn is getting there. I think he's going to snap if this goes on much longer. But I'm glad Winn is getting there being like, what are we doing? This is ridiculous. I think that Supergirl needs some female friends beyond her sister Alex. All right, so what else did I not like? All right, so the fourth thing that I didn't like about the episode was when Maxwell Lord said, may the best girl win. And I was like, ew. I think that it was obviously a play on may the best man win. But, you know, one of the great things about the show is it has so many wonderful female characters that aren't superpowered. Alex Danvers, Cat Grant. And I think that, you know, if you're dealing with people who are obviously grown women, including Supergirl, by the way. I mean, I guess they had to call her Supergirl because of the comic, but I think that, you know, I think it creates like a feeling of ageism and like expiration dates, and I just feel it's really not a good thing to do, and I think a show like Supergirl shouldn't perpetuate that kind of like thing that happens in pop culture, right? Where women are referred to as girls, you know, and men are referred to as men. Like, that's the ideal. Men and girls. And you're like, men and girls can't go together. That's illegal. So anyway, that's just like, it just really rubbed me the wrong way. So I did not like that at all. Just like I said, you know, the episode title next week is for the girl who has everything. How about for the woman who has everything? All right, then finally, Jimmy Olsen. This Jimmy Olsen situation last night, they really kind of set it up and they said, okay, this is the big overarching B storyline for this show, or romantic subplot, at least, that Jimmy and Kara can't be together. And it's like, I agree with Winn. Why can't you be together? And I think it's all on Jimmy, but I think that Winn was totally right to say, what you're doing to Lucy is also unfair, because who wants to be with someone when you're not their first choice? And that's what Jimmy's doing to Lucy, out of some weird feeling of, like, that he owes it to her, or loyalty. It's like, well, we were dating. It's like, well, you fell in love with someone else, and Lucy seems like a really nice person. And I think if you're just honest and upfront with it, instead of, like, stringing her along and, you know, making this embarrassing for her, I think she'd be okay with it. She's not going to be okay with it at this point, because, you know, she moved to the city to be with you. I mean, I just feel that Jimmy has put everybody in a really bad position, except for Winn. You know, Winn's fine, but I think that Kara, Lucy, and himself are all much worse off because of this weird feeling of, you know, loyalty. It's very frustrating. I don't like seeing it on the show. I think it's super realistic to stuff that happens in real life, but television is supposed to be a fantasy. We get annoyed by this kind of relation stuff in real life. I don't need to be frustrated with it on TV, especially because it's not going anywhere. I have it happen in a couple episodes. Yeah, that's fine. But if this is going to be like one of those, like, you know, they have these unrequited relationships all the time on TV. It's supposed to be actually part of the formula, like back from Sam and Diane and Niles and Daphne. And, you know, it's like and Ross and Rachel. It's like this thing where they're like, oh, unrequited love. This will keep people invested. But I feel, I don't know, it's such an obvious thing. And they've moved the Kara and Jimmy relationship forward so much at this point that I don't want to have to sit through this for much longer. And I'm curious how you feel about it. All right. Thank you so much. Those are my thoughts on the latest episode of Supergirl. I'm very curious to hear if you think this episode was a little bit of a misstep for the show, or if you enjoyed it and think they're still right on track. Share your own lists down below, and you can check out some other episodes right now.